A week after the deadly fire at an artist warehouse space in Oakland, California, known as the Ghost Ship, killed 36 people, fire departments around the country are investigating so-called live-work spaces. These are places often inhabited by artists and low-income residents. There's ever less affordable housing today in many metro areas, pushing people to new measures and extremes. And again to Hari, who has been working with our team on this story.
Everybody's watching us, and all of the other cities, it's like becoming a national crisis.
In art warehouses across Oakland, people are anxious their way of life is under threat.
All of the survivors live in warehouses or occupy warehouses, and we're all grieving, and people who are survivors are now at risk for losing their home.
Fears of a backlash from city inspectors and property owners are beginning to materialize.
This week, my leaseholder told me the landlord was scared of people living in our space and has asked anybody living there to move out by January 3rd.
Painter and photographer Angela Scrivani has been living and working in this Oakland art studio for the past 8 years. She's asking city officials to differentiate between a dwelling that's unsafe versus one that's just not permitted properly.
A lot of the spaces that I've been in where we didn't pull permits to build the areas in which we live and work, we built them to code. It's such a desperate situation that we were willing to take the risk and hoped that it wouldn't come to this.
Oakland is not alone in cracking down on buildings not zoned for residents. LA, Dallas, Nashville, and New Haven have all put landlords and tenants on notice to clear out buildings that might be substandard living conditions. Baltimore is taking it a step further. Que Pequeño is a multimedia artist. He'd been living in this building known as the Bell Foundry until earlier this week. On Monday, the city evicted him and 9 other artists without warning.
Bell Foundry is just an example of what's going to happen to like more spaces like this, not only in Baltimore, but in like different cities.
Artists could live, work, and party at the Bell Foundry. It was also a sanctuary for the LGBTQ community and artists of color, according to Pequeño.
My next move, hopefully, is to find a new safe space for black and brown artists, for black and brown people in Baltimore, from Baltimore.
The Bell Foundry was never zoned for residential use, and it was unsafe, according to Kathleen Byrne, who's responsible for permits and code enforcement in Baltimore's housing department.
It was an accident waiting to happen. There were tons of flammables and combustibles, as well as debris located, and it warranted imminent danger. So it wasn't just a matter of not getting the proper permits.
Even with the wake-up call in Oakland, these safety issues are nothing new for Baltimore.
It's probably every code enforcement official's worst nightmare, what happened in Oakland. But these are things that we deal with on a daily basis. They're just not in the public eye.
The Bell Foundry's closure has put other Baltimore artists on high alert that their spaces could be targeted next.
I'm terrified. I feel like someone's going to take it away.
Stuart Watson owns Area 405, a massive mixed-use space converted from a 19th-century factory. Watson spent 14 years getting the building up to code.
The sprinkler system happened pretty quickly. The firewalls in the stairwells was within the first couple years. But the other things have taken time. Updating electrical and things like that has taken a long time.
It's a process, she says, must be done to keep artists safe.
Not providing safety for the people who entrust their lives to you is unconscionable. People trust me with their lives, and I don't take that lightly.
Because many artists lack the resources to operate safe spaces, the Greater Baltimore Cultural Alliance advocates on their behalf. Executive Director Jeannie Howe.
One of the most frequent calls we get is a search for space of some kind. And we've put together a couple of tools that help match folks with available space. We value this community tremendously. We value these artists and we value their contributions to the city.
This is the time we brought Janelle Monae to a downtown city street.
Robbie Cowell has been producing major outdoor music parties in San Francisco for 19 years. He says that if cities are serious about retaining their artists, they need to recognize that art spaces are critical.
These warehouse spaces are the only places where they can afford to not only live, but pay that second rent to actually have a studio to create their work.
And he warns that regulatory effort could drive artists into more dangerous spaces.
Artists will find another place to make art, so I would just advise the public officials to concentrate on harm reduction over code compliance, right? It's a very big difference.
That's what San Francisco does when it comes to regulating live performance spaces. Jocelyn Kane heads the city's Entertainment Commission.
We're much safer than other cities where people are somewhat scared to come to government, and we have tools that we use in our toolbox to allow people to consider using like an out-of-the-box crazy space to do an event that would be unique or different, and then we can sort of guide them through in a way that feels safe to them.
Kane says that since many artists rely on income from live performances, it's important they have easy access to spaces where they can safely host these events.
I'm sitting in City Hall, I'm a part of government, and I'm trying to be an advocate as much as possible within the confines of what we call responsible hospitality.
Stuart Watson, owner of Area 405 in Baltimore, hopes more artists will also be able to invest in safe spaces.
I want artists to buy places. I want them to fix them. I want them to think that living in places that are not fixed up is okay.
And that's just what Que Pequeño is climbing toward. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Hari Sreenivasan.